Well, I am very happy to work in many Latin American countries, but it's a pity that I have not the opportunity to work in an English-speaking country, and you will very quick discover why. So this is the English I manage, and I hope perhaps it's useful to wake up you from the wishes nap. Well, good afternoon. I wanted to thank INCOR for inviting me to this conference. I hope my contribution telling you about an effort we made in the early 2000s in Memoria Abierta will be useful for you. The oral archive was able, not without tensions and dilemmas, to combine in a virtuous manner the academic methodology and the human rights goals and knowledge about the labors of memory. I will talk about the Argentinian experience, a country that from 1976 to 1983 experienced the last and cruelest military dictatorship of its history, a military regime that received the cooperation of civilians and business sector, of parts of the Catholic Church and the conservative politicians. In fact, the period of violence from the state trying to annihilate the guerrilla groups started before. We are talking about serious human rights violations since the appearance of the paramilitary group of Alianza Anticomunista Argentina, AAA, in 1974 during the government of Juan Domingo Perón. Since the end of the dictatorship, there were a variety of developments regarding three topics: truth, justice, and memories. The interesting point is not only that each one of these was linked with the two others, but that in the main event of the process involving them, the tipping points were always related with archives, more generally with voices, with testimonies. So it is not correct to say that we like archives. The thing is that we cannot work in human rights without archives, either identifying and finding those that remain hidden or creating new sources. Then, based in the strong idea of the right to the truth that refers to both the individual and collective right to know, later recognized as principle of the UN, I will refer to the creation of new historical sources through an audiovisual archive. I will mention from now the principal steps in the long struggle for justice when testimonies appeared, written, oral, or audiovisual, and played a central role in this long way of truth and justice. ...1983, free elections and recovered democracy after Falkland-Malvinas War. One of the first decisions of the new government was the revocation of the amnesty the army had passed to benefit themselves, and the creation of the National Commission of Disappeared Persons, CONADEP, our truth commission. It was the first in this kind of investigation commission. And for this, the human rights organization worked very hard together to hand over to the commission thousands of testimonies from the survivors or from the victims' relatives collected by this human rights group during the dictatorships. Again, there were written testimonies. The commission received more than 9,000 denounces, which were also registered as written testimony also, about disappearances and used them for the investigation and as a connecting thread of the report called Nunca Más, Never Again. Each of these files acted later as the basis for many other actions, especially in the policies of reparation developed during the 90s. Immediately after the Truth Commission, the CONADEP Commission, we have the quite famous trial to the military juntas. It was really a tipping point and the beginning of a process of prosecution to the perpetrators. 1984 was the, excuse me, it was not a year, 1,984 was the number of witnesses initially called by the prosecutors. 833 of them presented testimony. After 27 years, Memoria Abierta succeeded in digitizing the whole filmed document of the 530 hours of this trial in cooperation with the federal court and the Salamanca University from Spain. The trials were back and forward after this first trial, and almost three decades later, after impunity laws and pardons, we recovered the initiative in 2004, and we are still judging the perpetrators. Quite 5 years later, in 1995, Adolfo Silingo's confession about the death flights methodology used to eliminate the prisoners, consisting of dropping them alive from planes to the Rio de la Plata, were a very, very shocked public testimony. There were various interviews on TV, and the complete testimony of Capitán Adolfo Silingo was published on a book titled The Flight. It was very interesting talking about testimonies because there were not a new that was a very quite sure methodology used by the dictatorship. During the military junta trial, there were some reference to this methodology. But it was necessary, this public confession, to put on the ground, to put in the political and in the social scenario, this very rude and terrible truth. In 1998, because of all these continuous discoveries about the dictatorship and the terror of the state, because of a specific legal action at a regional level, I am not referring to this, we established the truth trials. These truth trials, in Spanish, juicios por la verdad, as they were called, were an innovation in the process of justice. They were unlike ordinary criminal trials in that judicial action was expressly limited to investigation and documentation, without there being a possibility either of prosecution or punishment. They were based again on the right, both of the relatives and of the society as a whole, to know the truth, and the right of the relatives to bury and mourn their dead. New opportunities for testimonies. In many cases, there were audiovisual records. There is audiovisual records of them. All this event, specifically the big impact generated by Silingo confessions, and 1 year later, because of the abundance of ceremonies of homage, demonstrations, cultural activities, performance of any kind, and productions, TV programs, among others, in the occasion of the 20th anniversary of the coup d'etat, generated a special environment, a social humor, an optimal time for memory. We are talking of the end of 90s. This is an image of the commemoration of the coup d'etat. It was at the end of the 90s when Memoria Abierta was founded. One of its first actions, projected in the main proposal called To Remember, was to build up an oral archive that now has more than 900 testimonies. It was an optimal time for memory, and there is not a place, because there is not a place, an institution with capacity and credibility, a new space or a space that were able to convoke people to tell their experiences, to narrate and leave a legacy for future generations. There were before isolated testimonies made for dissertations, for foreign television productions, or by independent video makers. There were also all the materials, all the documents coming from the CONADEP and from the trial to the military junta, but with confused legal frames and not accessible at all to the general public. Individual testimonies, isolated interviews, is not the same as an oral archive, as a systematic initiative. Our main purpose was to stop losing the stories. People were dying, and we had a deep sense of urgency. We wanted to create sources to think about the period, to produce reflection about experience, learning, legacy, cultural artifacts for a future museum. So we contracted the very best professional at that time in the country, Dora Schwarzstein, a historian specializing in oral history, and she selected then a team of three historians. We elaborate a chronology about the period. We design a model or pilot guide for interviewing, which was every time adapted by the interviewers in the preparation of the sessions. We established categories for the people bringing their testimonies, and we decided which categories have priority because of the age of the people and to keep balance in terms of representativity of what happened during the period. Our categories was mothers, fathers, you know that the biological links are extremely important in memories in my country. So mothers, fathers, or parents, grandparents, siblings, children, partners, other relatives, militants, survivors of the clandestine center of detention, political prisoners, exiled, deported, other social actors, intellectual, artists, professionals, public officials, national or foreigns, and foreigns, member of political parties, religious, members of religious organization, trade union or social organizations, etc. We established a set of rules, parameters for the whole process of creating the source, procedures of filming, legal permissions, ways of storage, the way of making the synthesis of the interview that we modified several times to improve it, the cataloging and index technique of each one. At the time when the archive started to be consulted, to be open to the public, we wrote the rules for the use of the sources, the quotation, the commitment of the users, etc. We had a lot of difficulties to set up the archives. Perhaps we can think it's a very expensive initiative, but we have quite enough money. The methodology is available. I have at the institution quite smart people decided to work and to share their knowledge. Nothing is enough. There were many other variables taking part in the project. The amount of money, of course. The level of trust of the victims in the institution. The priorities you establish. The prudency in testing the results. The way that you manage the problematic cases. The dynamic you are able to create in the archive and with the archive for playing a role in the process of memory. The real challenge is how to use it besides open to the consultation on our office where the majority of the people is always academic people or people from the academia and normally the majority of them coming from the north. Nobody have that doubts about the value, historic, ethic value of the archive, but the key point is how to use for a productive memory. Excuse me, I have, well, this is a very primitive, but it was our first product, it was in CD, at that time, is like a historical chronology, and I need now to go with Michael instruction to this. I have made the previous review linking historic event in the events in the process of coming to terms with our past, with the type of testimonies collected by human rights groups and by the entities of the government in each moment. These documents were not part at the beginning of our oral archive because they are not usable, they are not open to the public. It's useful perhaps in this moment say that Memoria Abierta developed a very strong strategy advocating for the free of information, free access to public information.
Oh, interdisciplinaria que ha desarrollado la sociedad argentina por la justicia, ¿no? Realmente el haber conseguido todo.
But we need these documents to use them in combination with contemporary stories. Our pieces in our oral archive, in many cases, there were the same witness bringing testimonies in different phases of this process. But the context and the setting for the interview is totally different. So more and more, we made big efforts to have, in one hand, a wonderful oral archive, but to produce lots of materials to use this archive in a positive way to work and to force the memory work in the public scenario. Having made several multimedia products using testimonies from our archive, we were able to disseminate the beneficial effects of a collection of testimonies which invigorate the field of memory studies and the discipline itself, making also a contribution to social memories. I know that I leave lots of concepts very important to have an oral archive, but I am ready to answer your questions during this moment.